सूत्रभाष्य कृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ सहना भवतु, सहनौ भुनक्तु, सह वीर्यं करवावहै, तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः। यो ब्रह्माण विजाति गुरु वेदाश्च प्रणोति तस्मै तव महदेवमात्मबुद्धि प्रकाश मोक्ष वै शरणमहं प्रपद्यं। शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। श्री चिद्घनेशरम मह्यं सुखं नित्यं सप्रकाशं व्यापकं नामरूपाधिष्ठानं बुद्धि बोध्यं बुद्धि परं सर्ववेदान्त वेद्यं प्रत्येक परम तदेव अन्नमत्तोऽन्यदिति मे निश्चिता मतिः। So continuing with the fifth chapter, we looked at the jnana, which is pramana and prameya adhina. Whereas dhyana, the difference is dhyana is not pramana or prameya adhina. Dhyana is kartra adhina. So karta has a choice how to do it. And then whoever understands the teaching of the Shruti, what is revealed, Aikya, without any doubts, then that person is a Jnani. And there are many who, due to lack of Chitta Shuddhi, because of the earlier preparation lacking, Sadhana Chaturte Sampatti, they have many doubts or they do not understand at all. Thereby, after Shravana also, Dhyana is prescribed. We see this in Keno Upanishad also. In Keno Upanishad, in fact, the Keno Upanishad itself is meant for an Uttama Adhikari. You look at it, it starts with a question by a Shishya, Keneshitam Preshitam Patati Manaha. So that question itself is so complex. Initially, a sadhaka cannot have, a basic sadhaka who does not have any background in any Vedanta, cannot have such a question. So there itself you see that the Shishya's question itself shows the preparation, whereby how does one reach there is not shown in all Upanishads. Even in Bhashya, Bhagavan Bhashyakara just says Sadhana Chaturte Sampatti. These are covered in the Prakarana Granthas. And Bhagavan Bhashyakara assumes that a sadhaka who has reached Vedanta has done Veda Purvanga. The Purva Karmakanda has been followed by a person. Now many of us who have not followed, they will have trouble understanding when even the question, Keneshitam Preshitam Manaha, there itself will have trouble. Even then, the Upanishad talks about others also. When does it talk about it? Although it is catering to the advanced students initially, then the others who are there, because the answer that the student, just give me a moment, please. Sorry, yeah. The answer that the student gives when the teacher asks him whether you have understood it well, initially, the student gives an answer which is not acceptable to the guru. He says, this is not the complete understanding because you are holding on to sagunatvam. This you can do in dhyana, but this is not jnana. Then there's a refrain. You see many mantras like that. And then you said, you have to do vichara, further vichara. Then the shishya does the manana and he comes back, nididhyasana, and he comes back. And then he says, now I understand. So he understands the neti neti prakriya. You cannot say that I understand well. Vijnatam. You cannot say Brahma Vijnatam. You cannot objectify it. So initially he was objectifying it. Now, after understanding it, spending some time in Ekanta Vasa Ityadi, he understands that the tattva which is being talked about is me who is a subject who can never objectify himself. And then he says, whoever gets this jnana, he says it in own words. He does not paraphrase the, he does not parrot the Shruti. He does not parrot the Guru's teachings. And rather, he paraphrases it in his own words. The same jnana is given. And then he also says that whoever gets this among us, whoever gets this jnana that I have got will be free. So he's so confident that he's already free because it is pratyaksha to him. Sorry, so it is as clear as pratyaksha. So pratyakshavat pratyakshatvam. That is sakshatkara. Then the other asks, you know, Upanishadam bho bruhi. So please teach Upanishad. So there's a question there. And then the Acharya says, Upanishad has been taught to you. What has been taught is Upanishad itself. And then Dhyana is also taught in many Upanishads. I mean, I may be mixing Upanishads also. In Mundaka, you take it, Dhyana is taught later. Why is Dhyana taught later? Now, this is where others get confused. Others, as in other Darshanikas, they get confused. Even in Vedanta, they say, no, Shravana is not sufficient. Nididhyasana Rupa, that Dhyana, Samadhi Rupa Dhyana is mandatory. But it is not so. We see that one Shishya has got it, for the others to clarify, Upanishad has been taught, but you didn't understand it yet. You will understand it when the chitta becomes more shuddha. For that, dhyana is prescribed, whereby it will work on chitta shuddhi also, vasana kshaya also, and parallelly, the jnana which has already, you know, been sown as a seed by the guru, that will fructify. So there, the process is such that dhyana is for chitta shuddhi itself, or as Bhagavan Vidyaranacharya says in 9th chapter, you cannot explain and pinpoint what exactly dhyana is doing and how it is doing, but its karya is known. Its karya is known that a person who was doing shravana as well and was not getting it, he starts to get what was being taught earlier. So shravana itself fructifies, and we need not insist also. Those who want to hold on to say, no, Nididhyasana gives moksha, at least it is preceded by shravana, we are okay. I mean, we don't need to argue because it's a wasteful exercise. We are clear that without shravana, there cannot be moksha. Now, if dhyana is necessarily an add-on, one can say along with it, if he person prefers to say that I got moksha with dhyana, we need not argue. Because shravana is preceding, that is an invariable there. Okay. So coming back to our dhyana section in the Vichara Sagara, we have seen there are various groups of dhyanas, and these were mentioned in the section in brief. Now, he gets into each and every dhyana in detail. Initially, he says, Tatra chitta vrittehe vikshepe sati hatat tam stiri kuryat. What was being talked about? Nairantiran dhyakara chitta vritti pravaha hi dhyanam. Dhyana is defined as chitta vritti pravaha. Nairantiran tailadharavat. So, like a tailadhara, if the dhyaya vastu is held on in the vritti, in the antakarana, it takes the dhyakara, and if you hold on to that, that is called as dhyana. So, dharana culminates into dhyana. Right now, into dhyana. So, we'll say this is a culmination. We need not talk about samadhi. One holds on to the vritti. Tatra, chitta vrittehe vikshepe sati, hatat tam stiri kurya. So, one hatat shows that now a person has not been led into samadhi. One has to hold on to it. As and when one slips, one has to bring back the vritti. Whatever that vritti is, as mentioned earlier, whether it is salagrama, being focused on, or whatever it is. Jnana rupa antakkarana vrityudaya kala eva vishyavarana bhangasya siddhatva vritti sthaira sampadanasya nasti upayogaha. So he says, Jnana rupa antakkarana vritti udaya kala eva. When the jnana vritti is coming up, jnana rupa antakkarana vritti is taking the jnanakara, whatever the jnana is about. Then, eva vishayavarana bhangasya. Ajnana goes away. Siddhatva, the Ajnana Bhanga has taken place when the Jnana took place. Now, if a person is doing Jnana, it is not going to further take away Ajnana because it is already gone. Therefore, Vritti Sthairya Sampadanasya Nasti Upayoga. Upayoga in case of Ajnana Nivritti. Ajnana Nivritti is not going to be the result of Dhyana. Ajnani going into Dhyana or Samadhi comes out as an Ajnani. And a Jnani going into Samadhi comes out as Jnani. So there should be no doubt as to what is the role of Dhyana. Dhyana is not going to take away Ajnana. It is just going to give Sthairya. So Sthairya Sampadanasya Upayogaha Nasti. In the case of, for what purpose? You have to be very clear. It has no purpose in taking away Ajnana. Tasman na Jnane Hata Apeksha. So for Jnana, there is no Apeksha of Hata. Whereas in Dhyana, there is Apeksha of Hata. One can have a control and one should try to control the mind, hold on to the Vritti and make the mind composed. Then the Shravana which was done earlier may fructify. But here we are looking at the difference. So Hata is possible in Dhyana, it is not possible in Jnana. Tasman na Jnane Hata Apeksha. Now Ahangraha Dhyanam. What is Ahangraha Dhyanam? Aham. One has to hold on to Aham. Where should one hold on to Aham? So that varies. It can be in your Ishta Devata also. One can have Aikya by trying to do Dhyana on oneself. Instead of using Saligrama and thinking of it as Vishnu, one can think of one's own self as Vishnu. So your Dhyaya Vastu, instead of being an objectifiable Padartha outside, it is your own body-mind-sense complex. In fact, if you look at it, this is the purpose of even Anganyasa. When we do Anganyasa, that time also, what we are invoking the deity within. So it is not really Ahangra Upasana, but it is comparable. It is leading to that. So Vaikunta Vasi Chaturbhuja Vishnu Dhyanavat Aham Brahma Iti Dhyanam Api Dhyaya Swarupanu Sari Eva Dhyanam Natu Pratika Dhyanam. So there is no separate Pratika. You yourself are the object of Dhyana, whereby you think yourself as either Vaikunta Vasi Chaturbhuja Bhuja Vishnu Dhyana, the way you are doing. But here, Aham Brahma Iti Dhyanam Api. Dhyaya Swarupa Anusari Eva Dhyanam. So, Dhyaya Swarupa Anusari. It is in keeping with the Dhyaya Vastu. Whether it is Vaikuntavasi Chaturbhuja Vishnu or it is Brahma. Brahma does not have a particular Akara. But if you take Saguna or Nirguna, Dhyana is possible in Ahangraha. On oneself as the deity or as Brahma. Kintu idam ahangraha dhyanam dhyaya swarupasya swabhinnataya anusandhanam ahangraha dhyanam uchyate. So what is ahangraha dhyanam? This, what is it? Graha, grahana. Grahane swabhinnataya anusandhanam. That is the meaning of aham is swabhinnataya and anusandhanam is the meaning of grahana or graha. That is the dhyana. And in keeping with Dhyaya Swarupa, therefore Dhyaya Swarupasya Swabhinnataya Anusandhanam is what is Ahangraha Dhyanam. Yasya Vedanta Vichare Api Aparoksha Jnanam Na Udeti. So one holds on to the Paroksham as what? Brahma Asti. Aham Asmi is quite difficult to understand. One is unable to say even. One is asked to say, one is unable to say because no, I don't think so. I'm not there yet. In that case, Saha Vedasya Ajnarupa Upasana Vijivakye Vishwasavan. Sorry, I'm having some trouble due to cold, so kindly pardon me. So Saha Vedasya Ajnarupa Upasana Vijivakye Vishwasavan Nairantaryena Hatat Aham Brahmasmiti Ahangraha Dhyanam Anutishthet. So what should that person do? He is not interested in Sagunatvam. He is not interested in going back to Karmakanda and doing all sorts of upasanas. He is interested in moksha. He knows that Jnanena Moksha, but he is not able to understand at all. No matter how much he has done Shravana, he is not able to hold on to the, and he is not able to reach the understanding, let alone hold on. Then the Acharya in the Upanishads, they say, you do Dhyana on this. So like a, it is said like a, you know, like lightning. Brahma is like lightning, like a flash of lightning. That's one dhyana taught in the Upanishad. So there are so many such ideas in the Upanishad on which one can do dhyana. Ahangraha is one that I am, that Brahma has already been taught. Even if you do not understand, you do dhyana on it. Not that dhyana will fructify into jnana, but dhyana will do something to the antakkarana which is not ready. It will make it ready in such a manner that purva shravita, whatever has been, you know, taught to you, that becomes clear. Because he is Vishwasavan, Vidivakya Vishwasavan. He knows that Shruti says it is going to happen, it will happen. So there should be no doubt as to how can dhyana lead to this. Jnanena Moksha has been said, how can this take place? That should not be the issue. Shraddha should be sufficient. So Nairantaryana Hatat Aham Brahmasmi iti Aham Graha Dhyanam Anutishtet. Why Aham Graha? Because Aham, Aham is there and it is Dhyana. It is not a Mahavakya analysis. There is no Chintana there. There is no Manana. Tasya Krameda Jnanotpatti Dwara Moksha Siddhyati. Krameda Jnanotpatti should take place. Which is due to Shravana. He may be continuing Shravana or the earlier Shravana itself will work. Moksha Siddhyati. So there was a tippan on this dhyana, and then there is a second tippan also. Let's finish that off. Yasya buddhi shastrokte parokshe dhyena sahasa stiri bhavati sa purusha prerakena shastra vidina bodhite parokshe dhyaya pratinidhi bhute pratyakshe salagramado anyasmin va dhyaya vishnu buddhi karana rupam anya buddhi karana rupam va pratika dhyanam kurya. So we have seen this, no details are here. Pratika dhyanam kurya. Pratika is there. Some object is there on which dhyana is to be done as per the shastra. So shastra vidina bodhite. Whatever has been taught by shastra, in that manner alone one should do dhyana. That should be the only pratika. You cannot take any other pratika and you cannot do dhyana any which way. It has to be the way it has been taught. The padartha cannot be changed. The pratika cannot be changed. Aham brahmasmi iti nirguna upasanam. Tu ahangraha dhyanam dhyaya swarupanusaritva tasya. Why is this not pratika dhyana, this ahangraha upasana? Because aham brahmasmi iti nirguna upasana. It is a nirguna upasana one. And what is it? It is holding on to oneself. It is not a pratika. You don't need any other pratika. You yourself are the object of dhyana. Therefore, dhyaya swarupanusari. And what kind of you? There is no superimposition here. Although one is doing dhyana, which itself may be superimposition, but in fact, there is no superimposition. Why? Because one is really Brahma. In the case of pratika dhyana, pratika adhyasa is being done on the pratika. Adhyasa, actually adhyasa is what? Atasmin tadbuddhi. That pratika saligrama, which is not Vishnu, on that atasmin, on not non-tat is on that which is not Vishnu, on that kind of a salagrama, one has Vishnu buddhi, tad buddhi. So, avishnu Vishnu buddhi is atasmin tad buddhi, that is also adhyasa. But the difference is, why is it called dhyana? Because you know that it is adhyasa. It is done with the understanding and it is prescribed by the Shastra. So technically it is also Adhyasa, but it is an Adhyasa which the Shruti recommends for a particular phala. But in the case of Ahangraha Dhyana, Aham is not a Pratika. It is not really an Adhyasa, although one does not understand. One thinks that it is Atat, meaning I am Aham, Abrahma. This is the problem there, because one is not convinced yet. So one, in thinking, one knows that the Shruti says, I have Shraddha in the Shruti. Shruti is saying, Aham Brahma. But in my understanding, Aham Abrahma. Therefore, when Shruti says, Aham Brahmasmi, do the dhyana at least, then this person is superimposing really. Is doing an adhyasa of Brahma on Aham. But still, it is not a pratika because it is this adhyasa. In his understanding, it is adhyasa. In his misunderstanding, it is adhyasa. So there's a double negation really. Factually, he is Brahma. Therefore, dhyaya swarupanusaritva tasya, it is not. It is a comment on saying that why it is not pratika dhyanam. Okay, so anyway, it is the reason it is not pratika dhyana is because it is dhyaya swarupanusari. Yadyapi atra, so in the second tippana, which was moksha siddhyati, jnana dvara, there the tippana kara says, yadyapi atra dhyana vishayi bhutam brahmana paramartha rupam, kintu manak kalpitam eva. Now this is the adhyasa. Even in the case of aham graha upasana, there the brahma that one is superimposing is manak kalpitam. The Shruti says this, this is in this manner, so I have to think there because I have no clarity yet. Thereby, tasmat tadvishayaka chittavritti pravaha rupa dhyanam api bhranti jnanam eva. Thereby, it is also adhyasa, it is bhranti jnana. Na yathartha jnanam, it is not jnana. Had it been with understanding, it would have become jnana, and then his jnana would have been chintana rupa nididhyasana. It would have been jhai chintane. And then there will be abhyasa by sanpratya nididhyasa. But here one does not have jnana at all, aikya jnana. One is not convinced about it. Manana siddha, it isn't. Therefore, it is not yathartha jnanam. Therefore, it is bhranti jnanam. And bhranti jnana has led to dhyana as prescribed. Tathapi, Mani prabhayam, mani buddhi rupa, samvadi bhrantya, dhavataha pumsa, mani jnana dvara, mani rabhavat, prakruta ahangraha dhyanena, brahma jnana labhena moksha siddhyatyeva. So now the Purva Paksha is asking as to how can this bhranti jnana lead to jnana and jnana lead to moksha? Because what has been said in the Mula, tasya kramena, jnanotpatti dvara moksha siddhyati. And what is that in its krama, jnana has to take place, then moksha has to take place. So this jnana has to be aikya jnana, which should be yathartha jnana. But how can yathartha jnana come from ayathartha bhranti jnanam? Bhranti jnana leading to yathartha jnana is questionable. Puru Pakshi is saying, how is that possible? So this is answered in the 9th chapter of Panchadashi also. The example is given. So there is a samvadi bhranti. So there are two types of bhrantis. I'll just mention it. There are, let's say, two people who are both having bhranti. What is, because, see, what is bhranti here? If one does not have yathartha jnana, then it is bhranti definitely. If one does have yathartha jnana, or rather one knows one thing as that very thing, let's say money. So here money example is taken. Let's take that. Let's say there is a diamond or a money, you can say money itself. So you can say, what do you call it? The moti. So whatever you call it as, what is it called in English? Pearl, right? It's a pearl. So assume that it's a pearl or a diamond. Whatever shines more, so we and whatever looks like, you know, in the example of the shell silver, we see that the shell shines like a silver. So that example can be taken. But another example here is money. So you take a pearl which shines forth, or a diamond which shines forth, and you have, let's say, some lamp there. Lamp also shines. And let's say the lamp shines exactly the same way as the money. Now, if you are sure that it's a money, then it's a yathartha jnana. even if you are not sure that it is money, it can be yatharta jnana in reality, but you do not know. So you cannot say that I have jnana that there is money there. It looks like a money. It can be a bhranti, it may not be a bhranti. But from a distance, from a great distance, where for one who knows that it is a money, really, he owns it and he has kept that money, that person knows that it is money and he has yatharta jnana. And let's say he is testing you. He asks you, can you see that? Do you see what it is? Is it a lamp or a money? So you think it is a money, but you cannot be sure. So it is bhranti for you any which way. One who knows it, he alone has yatharta jnana. Even if you think you are 100% sure that it is money, but still you really don't know. You think you know, and there may be one off chance that it is not money, because the person is testing you. In that case, do you have yatharta jnana? You do not have. Now look at the other person who is not sure. He is also making a guesswork that it is a money, but he does not know at all. He has no confidence. So for in his case, at least you have to say that he has ayatharta jnana. Now this person who thinks that it is money, but he is not sure, he says, I don't want to waste my time. Now if the person who is testing, he says that I will give you that money. If it, whatever it is, or you know, it's a bet or something, I'll reward you if you guess it right. If you want to play along, well and good. If you don't want to play along, well and good. Now this person, in of course, I'm making it simpler or making it complicated, I do not know. But in the ninth chapter, there is no test or anything. There, the comparison between two people. One knows that it is money and runs towards it because he thinks it's money, and the other does not run towards it. Why? Because he does not think it is money. Now both are having bhranti jnana. Neither of the two have real jnana. But one who runs towards it, if it turns out to be money, he will get mani labha. Whereas the other won't get it. So that is explained here. So this is the Tippadakara is bringing the example from the 9th chapter of Panchadashi. Tathapi mani prabhayam mani buddhi rupa samvadi bhrantya dhavataha. It can be from a lamp also. But he says, let me take a chance. Dhavataha pumsa, one who runs towards it. When there is a shine from the mani, mani buddhi rupa samvadi bhrante, he thinks that it shines like money, it may be money. So he is not sure. Therefore, bhrantya, samvadi bhranti is there. Dhavata pumsa mani jnana dwara mani labhat. When he goes there, he knows that it is money, and then he is sure he has mani jnana now, and therefore he has mani labha also now. Similarly, prakruta ahangraha dhyanena brahma jnana labhena moksha siddhyatyeva. So now this person in this context, in the exemplified, this person who does not have jnana of aham brahmasmi clearly, but still he does the jnana like running towards it, as though running towards this jnana, he gets that jnana, and thereby jnana dwara moksha siddhyatyeva. This is a typo here. This chapter has 300, it ends at 316th avarta. So 294 to 316 is pranavopasana, pranavopasana nirupanam. There may be others also included there, but this is a long section and there is a division of various dhyanas. Pranave ahangraha dhyanam. So pranava is omkara. Pranave ahangraha dhyanam. Pranava is omkara. Omkara is nama of Ishvara. Ishvara is Saguna Brahma, Maya Sahita Brahma, who happens to be none other than the Nirguna Brahma. Or Pranava can be the name of Nirguna Brahma itself. Both are possible because in Kathopanishad we see that for Saguna as well as Nirguna Dhyana, Pranava is useful. So it like acts like a setu. Yamaraja says it is setu for both saguna and nirguna. Prakarantarena ahangra dhyanam idanim uchyate. So ahangra dhyana can be done in a different manner also. That is explained here. Pranava rupe omkare ahangra dhyanam mandukyadi shrutyanusarena sureshwaracharyehi katitam. So Bhagavan Sureshwaracharya explains how this ahangra upasana with pranava has to be done based on Mandukya Upanishad and other Upanishads also. So Tippanakara says there, where is it? Mandukya Shabdina Gaudapada Karika Api Grahya. So Mandukya Upanishad is the shortest Upanishad. It has only 12 mantras. But then Omkara is described there, the entire set of 3 chapters of Karika, which Bhagavan Gaudapada Acharya has written, that is quite huge, quite bulky. So that is also included by one says Mandukya. It is not Upanishad, it is Karika, it is Shastra, but still it is also called as Mandukya because it's a commentary on Mandukya in verse form. And then there is a commentary on that Bhagavan Bhashyakara writes on Karika also. So there he talks about Ahangra Upasana, which is there in the Upanishad itself. In the earlier Shruti section, in the 12 mantras, Omkara is talked about. In fact, the entire teaching is using Omkara there. Akara, Ukara, Makara, and then Avasana. And as an aside, the first chapter also has Karikas, meaning between the 12 mantras, some Karikas are there, which are in Anushtup Chanda. And Dvaitins, followers of Madhvacharya, they consider that as Shruti itself. So what Advaita Acharya has written, they misunderstand it and they consider it as Upanishad itself. So that is the Mahima of Karikakara. It is a Paurushya Grantha is considered as Apaurushya without the knowledge that it is written by Gaudapada Acharya. It is created by Gaudapada Acharya. So how is this dhyana to be done? Now again, Adhikari is also mentioned in some cases as to who is eligible to do this dhyana. So we have to be careful to understand. We look at the dhyana, whatever we understand, but we need not do it if we do not have Adhikara in it. So I'm just making it very clear. Since it is included, we are talking about it, but then we have to give respect to the Adhikaritvam in the dhyana also. So Pranava Rupe Omkare Ahangra Dhyanam Mandukyadi Shrutyanusarena Sureshwaracharyehi Kathitam Tad Anushthanam Api Uchitam Moksha Kamasya. So practicing this Upasana Dhyana is also, you know, it is fruitful for Moksha Ichchu, for a Mumukshu. Tasya Evam Kramaha. What is the Krama there? Sequence. Pranava Rupam Aksharam Brahma Swarupam Eva. So Pranava is the Akshara Brahma itself. Tadrusha Pranava Swarupa Brahma Aham Eva. And what is that Brahma? Shruti says Aham Eva. I do not understand it, but I know that Shruti says it. I am sure that it is so. However, in my case, I am having trouble to understand. Shravana is not completely fructifying yet. Manana, I have not been able to do sufficiently. Iti nairantarena anavaratan dhyayet. So one should do dhyana without a break. It should be a continuous pravaha on the pranava. Now pranava is not omkara symbol as drawn. Pranava is shabda rupa. Akara, ukara, makara, not the way you write it, because you can write it in any language. As long as it sounds the same, you can write in any language, but dhyana is not on that pratika, which is a form. It is form as in it is shabda rupa. It is not a akshara rupa in the sense of letters. So it should be on the shabda. Na etat samam kinchidapi dhyanam asti. So this is the best dhyana. And who is eligible in the best dhyana? Who has that kind of an adhikara? Who is best of the ashrama? So this is actually for, in fact, Omkara itself, uttering Omkara alone, even uttering it sukshma also without any other mantra, even a Vaidika has no adhikara, let alone others, avaidikas. or those who do not have Upanayana Samskara. Even those who have Upanayana Samskara, they do not have Adhikara in Pranava chanting. Just Omkara chanting should not be done. Only Sannyasi has an Adhikara. So there are people who keep on saying Om, Om, Om. He does not have Adhikara. And Shruti has given Adhikara only to a Sannyasi whose Gayatri Mantra itself is, he has no Adhikara in Gayatri Mantra. So it is not that Sannyasi has one Adhikara, he has more Adhikara in, and he has Adhikara in everything. That is not true. Grahastha, Brahmachari, these Vanaprasthis, they have Adhikara in Gayatri Mantra, which is a Shrestha Mantra, which is the essence of the entire Vedas. And Sannyasi gives up that Adhikara. Since he has given it, what is his equivalent there is Omkara. So we should not steal his mantra. Better take to Sannyasa if one is interested to do Omkara Dhyana. Is one how will one become eligible? I do not want anything, I want only moksha. That person is eligible for moksha by becoming ineligible for karma. We cannot hold on to everything and then say I'll do Omkara Upasana also. It will not fructify. It is Papakaraka. So, Etadhyanasya Vishesha Krama Sureshwara Acharyaihi Panchikaranakhe Granthe Pratipadita. Where is it? It is in Panchikarana. There is a Grantha called Panchikarana. Not the process of mixing up of Sukshma Panchamahabhutas and becoming grossified. Not that Panchikarana. Panchikarana Akhya. That is the name of the Grantha. There Bhagavan Sureshwara Acharya talks about this. Ahangra Upasana with Pranava. Etad Upasakaha Aparam Samsaram Tarati. And as Katopanishad also says, Mandukya Upanishad also says, one crosses over Samsara using this. Now this crossing over Samsara is in two ways. One, through reaching Brahmaloka, so Krama Mukti, or Jivan Mukti also if one gets Jnana here and now. Even if one goes to Brahmaloka, there also one has to get this Aikya Jnana, which is easier there of course. You know, like a Prakash and Chaya, Prakasha Chayavat. So it is like the contrast between Atma and Anatma there is very clear. Reaching there is extremely difficult, but then once one reaches there, it would be very difficult to not get Aikya Jnana. It would be very difficult to miss it, just exactly opposite to the way things are here. Atra Adhikari Sannyasi Eva. So Sannyasi alone has Adhikara on Ahangra Upasana with Pranava. Nirguna Pranava Upasanasya, Saguna Pranava Upasanasya cha Phalam. Now, Nirguna Pranava Upasana can also be done, Saguna also. So what is the Phala for each? And this is talked about in Katopanishad as well. Pranava Upasanam Aneka Upanishadsu Varnitam. So most of the Upanishads talk about it. In fact, without Omkara, no mantra starts really. Mandukya Upanishadi Visheshena Varnitam. Mandukya is completely committed to Omkara. It begins with Omkara, ends with Omkara. Therefore, Visheshena Varnitam. Tad Upanishad Vyakhyane Bhashyakarayihi Anandagiri Acharyaischa Vispashtam Varnitamcha. And it is there in the Bhashya as well as Bhagavan Anandagiri's Tika. Tatra yah kramah sayo vartikakarayi panchikarana granthe pratipaditaha. Vartikakara is Bhagavan Sureshwara Acharya. He has based his panchikarana on Upanishad as well as Bhashya and Tika. Tadrusha Prouda Grantha Vicharasam. I should not say based on Anandagiri also. Based on Bhagavan Bhashyakara's Bhashya. Because Vartikakara precedes Bhagavan Anandagiri. So, but it is detailed in the Tika as well. Tadrusha Prouda Grantha Vichara Asamarthanam Anayasena Bodhaya Pranavopasana Kramaha Atra Nirupyate. Although it is described there also it is a Prouda Grantha. It is not easy to understand what has been said there. And Dhyana should not be done by reading. Dhyana should be taught by a guru who has learnt in the Sampradaya. So it cannot be just you read this and this is how it has to be done, one does it. That's not complete Dhyana at all. In fact, this is how people feel in Tantra. Tantra Marga is also based on some of these written works where if one is not trained in Tantra, it will have absolutely disastrous results. Because what happens is that their krama is reversed or some steps are not mentioned at all. To preserve the sampradaya and to preserve the secret that it is, which can be dangerous also if it is not done right, therefore the books do not publish everything, right? The authors do not mention everything, right? And that is a case, maybe not that extreme, but it is a case, similar case in Upasanas also. Upanishatsu pranavupasanam dvidha varnitam parabrahma rupena pranavasya upasanam aparabrahma rupena pranavasya upasanam. So sagunatvam and nirgunatvam is mentioned here. Saguna is aparabrahma and parabrahma is nirguna. Nirgunam brahma parambrahma ityuchyate, sagunam brahma aparambrahma iti kirtyate, parabrahma rupena pranavupasakaha moksham eva labhate. So parabrahma upasaka with pranava, that person gets moksha. Why? Because aham brahma, nirguna brahma is the dhyana, ahangraha upasana, and there it is not in contrast with what has been taught earlier. Shravana has taken place, it is exactly similar. So that shravana is working as and when the dhyana is taking place. The shravana is working in the chitta, dhyana is cleansing the chitta, is making it more and more focused. There is not a wavering thought, then the earlier shravana starts working. Therefore, moksha meva labhate. Apara brahma rupena pranavupasakastu brahma lokam apnoti. The saguna brahma upasaka, even if he does ahangra upasana, he goes to brahma loka. Ittham nirguna saguna bhedena pranavupasanam dvividam. So there are two types of dhyana. Nirguna pranavupasana kramaha. So now this nirguna dhyana, how it has to be done, more details are given here. We'll look at it in the next part. Huh? I have another class to go to. सुकन्यत्यम सप्रकाशम व्यापकं नामरूप अधिष्ठानं बुद्धिबोध्यं बुद्धेर्दृक्यतं अपारं सर्वेदांत वेद्यं प्रत्यक्परमं तदेव अन्नमुक्तं इति मे निश्चिता मतिः. नमस्ते.
हरि ओम.